So, welcome back. With me is Z. Oh, I think I'll leave it there. Z. Wojna, who's also doing his PhD at University College London in the final year, and is also founder of TensorFlight. So his interest is in 2D image vision applications at scale and, well, deep learning methodologies. And he will present on a range of things, as I understand, but primarily on his work with Google.
Thank you. So I will talk mostly about like work that I did during PhD, partially with Google and partially with friends from UCL and partially from TensorFlight. Mostly focus on like how to make large scale system or like production computer vision systems that can be somehow useful. So I always start my talk with like three slight small joke. So let's have fun. A brief history of deep learning. We have like 60s and the model of perceptron appeared, and we were able to recognize like the sex of the person, like male versus female. That was a very exciting time, and we had like all this news that AI will change the world and blah, blah, blah. And then 20 years later, what have changed was like the stepwise function to a sigmoidal function. And thanks to this this small swap, we're able to do backpropagation and update all the parameters in the models in like single backward pass. So that was like, again, new exciting time and another, let's call it summer of neural networks. And 20 years later, in 2000, people proposed ReLU, and that actually appeared to be very, very exciting again, because now we can train deep models, and the vanishing gradient is not a problem anymore. So there is a little bit of truth in this joke, but yeah. So let me start from one of the latest projects, the devil in the decoders. So that was with friends from Google. Dense prediction problem, or like the problems that require per pixel prediction or understanding, are very common in computer vision and are like the only one that are useful. So it's broad range of problems like semantic segmentation, human part, key points, like the noising, colorizing, surface normal estimation, depth prediction, etc., etc. So most of the computer vision problem like on 2D that supposed to be useful are per pixel. And here is like large list of all these problems and could be probably added a few more. So the typical architecture, deep learning architecture for like solving such type of task is to use the some sort of pre-trained encoder from ImageNet. So it could be like Inception, Resnet, Resnex, etc. And then when we have our like high dimensional features of low resolution, we have to get back to per pixel prediction. So we need to upscale these low resolution features. They are very high dimensional, like usually 1,000 to 2,000 channels. So we use another like few layers of convolutions with upscale, and potentially we add like skip connections to like extract the details that were visible in like lower layers. So that is like, I would say, most of the architecture will look like, and it's difficult to design something different that would be better. But with this type of setup, what I can say is that like on that left part, the blue one, there was a lot of research, and we have as a community, we have designed a lot of amazing architectures that are very good in ImageNet. But when it comes to like upsampling and like decoding these features, actually there were at least only three papers that try to like understand that part of the network. So here is the list of like maybe more from 2017 of different great architectures. But if it comes to decoders, like we used to see like maybe two main works that were like cited in this context. One was exploring the way to upsample in for super resolution problem that was done by actually people from London, from Magic Pony Technology. And the second paper was about like optimizing the 5x5, the convolutional layer to be faster and kind of the same in the behavior for the depth prediction. So very limited use case usually. The third type of like I would say cited work was regarding the checkerboarder artifacts, which is I would say the most visible effect regarding the type of upsampling you can use. So for GANs, Chris Ola from Google, he analyzed the like details of what's happening with generated images. And you could see like this kind of checkerboarder artifact, like flips of like higher and lower values in the generated images. And there is actually very good and easy explanation for this effect, which we also studied and I will present in a second. So to do like more thorough study and actually like be comparable, we tried six different problems of different nature. So one would be like classification of pixel, another would be like regression of pixel values, and third would be kind of also like regression but in context of generation. So we don't have like not necessarily we have like very well designed loss function there. So with these six different tasks, we run actually a lot of different options of how to upsample the high dimensional features. So let's start one by one. How can you take the, let's say, 8x8 high dimensional feature and upsample it to 16x16? So one of the very common ways to do that is by transposed convolution. What transposed convolution is, it's kind of like reversed to the, let's say, 2x2 stride normal convolution. So if we would like look other way around, we would take like this 3x3 pixels and we would like generate one pixel in the next layer. Then we would like skip two pixels, we would look at these 3x3 pixels, and we would generate this middle pixel. What transpose convolution does, it generates from that single pixel like all the values here, or like maybe from the middle pixel, it would generate all values here in the next layer. But actually this generation is because we are dependent on much less values in the previous layer, is actually quite limited, and is exactly equivalent, transpose convolution is exactly equivalent to doing something like putting interleaving zeros, so black color is like zero, in between these pixels, and then applying just normal 3x3 convolution. That means like from this 3x3 part, I would get only, I would be based only on single pixel, but if I would like create the next pixel in the after like 3x3 convolution, I would be based on four pixels here. So this is easy explanation why we see checkerboarder artifacts. If the neighboring pixels are dependent on like single value and the next on four values, next one on single value, next one on four values, we obviously have to get like some sort of flickering inside, like in the output. Second way, or like another way to do upsampling is by subpixel convolution, or also called depth to space transformation. So this is a non-learnable layer. It just changes the order or like position of the values of the tensor. So if we would have like, let's say 3x3 tensor and of depth 4, we can actually change and shift the pixels from the depth dimension, so that would be like channels into the resolution dimension. So we would put this pixel here, this pixel here, this pixel here, and the fourth one here. So now from like four independent channels, we generate one larger image, but obviously we again see this like flickering of the neighboring pixels. So that's maybe slightly better than transpose, because we don't, we're not dependent on zeros, we may be dependent on like more similar values, but still. And in the like evaluation, we can actually show specifically that like this flickering is happening a lot in transpose convolution. It's happening, but not as much in the depth to space, and in other options, it's not happening. Another simple option is to do bilinear upsampling. So this is nice because it doesn't have this checkerboarder artifact problem. So if we would think about like upsampling this this tensor, we like this middle pixel would be just like average of these two pixels, and this is very smooth operation. The problem that we, I would say, have with this simple strategy is that it generates like unnecessary number of floats in your network. So if you think about this network, like this layer, that would have like maybe 8x8 in like that would be standard size, right? So it would be 8x8 in resolution and 2048 in number of channels. So now if I increase it by 2 on every like height and width sides, what we get is like 16x16 to 2048. It starts to be quite large tensor, and not really any value comes from such upsampling, because like this value, this is just duplication of like values inside. So we may hit like overfitting problem, we may hit that we are doing too much computation, the size of the tensor is too large, etc. So we would like to somehow change it. And our proposition is quite simple, but seems to be effective in this context. So what is good about bilinear upsampling is the fact that it's smooth. So I would say, okay, let's try this this upsampling strategy, but to reduce number of floats or like potentially computation and overfitting, let's just sum up like every four channels. And there is good explanation why summing up is potentially okay, because when we go from 2048 features, at the end of the network, you usually want to have maybe one, maybe three, 10 channels. Like if you want to if you want to generate images, we would generate like three channels, RGB. If you want to detect the depth of the pixel, you generate single channel. So we somehow have to get from like 2048 features to like single feature map, single output. Therefore, we have to decrease the number of channels in these tensors. So this is like obvious strategy to do this like in a smooth way, not jump directly from 2000 to 1, but let's jump like over a few layers from 2048 to 512, then to like 128, etc. So this is our proposition. What is also quite nice about such operation is that this is some sort of identity for upsampling. So we know that residual networks, so the network that has like identity plus convolved tensor, so we have convolution and we add this like output from this convolution to the previous tensor. So it works relatively well because it keeps the values, it keeps the gradient nicely. So there was like a lot of networks on ImageNet that use this residual network after the original paper. And this kind of models train well. But if it comes to upsampling, we never had this option to do this identity because we were missing ability to upsample and still keep like identity. In this context, we call the identity our layer from here. And then we add another convolution, like let's say transposed convolution, to be to be this like convolutional part in the residual network, and adding them up together like kind of creates like residual layer for upsampling. So if we compare we compared like six different types of upsampling. So we were looking at transposed convolution of decomposed transposed. So the composed transposed is like the composition of filter to like 1 by k and k by 1. So in our case, it would be like 3 by 1 and 1 by 3. You can always like decompose your matrix. We look at depth to space, but to keep them comparable, we always add convolution if there was no parameters learnable in the layer. Similar way for bilinear upsampling, we tried convolution. For bilinear upsampling, we also tried separable convolutions, which are like separable per channel. So it's like, let's say, one channel convolution on every channel. And our strategy, which is also non-learnable with convolutional layer. And we like compute number of parameters. They different a little bit, so it's difficult to control exactly this number, but overall we kind of keep still the average. And to give the results, so what we see for the classification-based pixel problems, we see that there is quite high variance between these different types of upsampling. We also tried like skip connections, so like adding this lower resolution, like higher resolution but lower dimensional features from the like lower layers in encoder. And we see that there is like a lot of different results for semantic segmentation, for instance edge. In context of kind of regression for depth prediction and colorization, we don't see so much of a difference, but in context of super resolution and GANs, which actually only consists of decoder. So when you do super resolution, you start from lower resolution image, you upsample it, so we don't have this encoder part, and the same for GANs. That actually influences a lot because decoder is like the main part of the network here. So now, if we compare like these numbers when we like add this like identity to every upsampling layer, so I would say we keep this this type of connection and we just add on the side this identity defined by us. So we see that like red numbers are there is more of red color. Let's call it like this. Red means better. So in some cases, this is actually a huge improvement, especially for these decoder-based problems like GANs and super resolution. There is like tremendous difference. In terms of colorization depth, not so much. And in terms of classification problems, it's kind of helpful. But I would say if you are ever trying to train GANs, it's like very good idea to try this type of upsampling because GANs are like very, like hyperparameter dependent, and it's quite helpful. And if we try to find like the most robust layer, which means the one that like always gives good results, so obviously like the upsampling layer in your decoder architecture for depth prediction, where you have like 100 other layers, you have hyperparameter optimization, data set cleaning, et cetera, is like the last thing you want to think about. So our upsampling layer actually is like very robust and like gives good results across all different problems. So here, if we look at the checkerboard artifacts like more in a more qualitative way, we can see substantial difference. So for example, this is depth prediction where we try to estimate the depth of the pixel. And transposed convolution, this is like effect of, we just replace like upsampling layer in the whole network. Everything else was exactly the same. So here you can see a lot of like these crosses, very well visible. The same here, the same here. If you look at depth to space, it's less of visible. Maybe it's quite visible here. is a little bit more smoother here. But if we look at the last column, which is our bilinear additive upsampling, we see that they are very smooth compared across the rows. So here is like a lot of crosses, even more, and extremely smooth. And the same for buff. I think this gives like nice results, especially for like 3D reconstruction problems where you don't want to like confuse your algorithm that are using this type of output. And here we just like compute quantitatively these artifacts. So to summarize, if you are playing with dense prediction problems, so like per pixel detection, prediction, estimation, it's good to try this bilinear additive upsampling as an upsampling layer. It's actually extremely simple, just 4 lines of code if you add like residual connection. And that should be like a very good start. Another project that I work with friends from Google was around like understanding the street view names and business names in the street view images. So there is this data set called Street, which consists of around 1 million images with up to four shots like that, where the task is to like read the name of the street. And it's actually much more complicated than OCR because of the real images. They often are occluded or like blurred or like from different angles. So here at the top, you see like nice example, but here you can actually see something that is much more difficult to read, at least on these middle images. Some of them don't have enough shots of the street sign. And what is interesting, like this is super difficult to read for human, and our labelers actually made a mistake, but the model was correct after the training. So a model learned better like language model. And this is also a little bit more complicated than OCR because we try to predict the canonical name. So if there are like other texts or like numbers on the street sign, we just want to skip them or omit them. The same like if there is another font or if there are like errors due to like problems with the sign. So here is like another difficult case where there are like two street names and we need to find one that is the right one. So we used attention-based model for that. So I would say that like standard attention from I think 2015 that take the different shots. That's like, okay, we just sum them up we just process them in parallel in the network and then like concatenate them for the input. Then we would like generate the attention mask, which is the like probability distribution over the spatial dimension that sums to one. And with that, we are supposed to like sum the features with the weights from this attention mask to generate one feature vector that regresses the letter in the in like LSTM or like any sequence model. So that's kind of typical attention. The problem with attention that at least we thought was is that if we use like off-the-shelf attention model that was designed for NLP, this is actually order independent model. In the sense, if you have like a sentence, like you can shuffle the words in the sentence and the attention model will still actually be exactly the same. So it still treat this, the translation wouldn't change because if you randomly shuffle the words, it actually doesn't matter for the model like the order of these words. And similarly for pixels, if we would shuffle these pixels in an order, in like random order, this is still exactly the same mathematical or like programming formula that that we are executing. So we thought this is actually a huge opportunity to exploit in this context because the text reading is like very, very location-based dependent. And our model is like very stupid that it's trying to search for like letters in the whole image. So we only should search around around the previous letter, let's say. And we tried a lot of ideas around that lines, coming from speech as well, because there are a few papers in speech community that also tried to do something like that, based on like convolutions and trying to estimate where was the previous attention, blah, blah, blah. Actually, we couldn't get it to make any better job. One thing that we found a little bit helpful, and around like 1%, was adding the representation, like one hot dimensional representation of the pixel locations in the channel dimension. So let's say if we would take like this lower dimensional, like lower resolution, high dimensional feature map after few layers of ConvNet, we would like count, okay, it can be from zero. What is this pixel? It's on the third position and fourth position in this dimension, and we would say, okay, this is fourth position, this is third position. So in our attention, like model could somehow relate the dimensionality of this value and try to maybe search with this attention kind of query from LSTM for the right vector that maybe is like one off in this dimension, in this channel. So the experiments that we did, we like compared different cuts of Inception, because like reading the text is easier problem than recognizing faces and types of dogs. So that's actually was very reasonable, and we got like 3 times faster network that gave the 2 times faster network that gave the best results, and also smaller. And if it comes to like this idea with one hot dimensional representation, we were around like 1% better with different architectures. Most of the mistakes in the test set that we like evaluated by hand were actually due to mistakes in the labeling, but there was still like opportunity to improve. And I think what is the most interesting from this work actually is this like kind of qualitative evaluation of attention masks versus like saliency map. So saliency map is like the gradient with respect to the input image that kind of shows how much a given pixel influences the output. So red color in this image would be saliency map for the given letter, and the green color would be attention mask. So attention mask is this mask generated from LSTM steps that kind of says where to take the, with like which location to take with the highest weight on the input image. So in the first iteration, when we supposed to read like the street name, like Rue, this is actually French data, like French street signs. And most of the street signs will start from Rue, Ruelle, Avenue. So there will be maybe like 10 different words total. So like the first snapshot of what attention is doing is just looking at the whole image and trying to capture the whole word. So like Rue. And after that, what is interesting, the LSTM is generating the UE and space without even looking at image. So there is no saliency map. There is maybe a little bit of weight here, but actually most of the weight is just placed on like on the left part of the image. So this is super interesting. Like the model just learns that, okay, when I'm looking at the left pixels, I just want to ignore my input. And this is like learned on their own, like why the model didn't learn to look at the right part or anything else. So after that, we see like more proper reading actually. So we skip character by character, or we go character by character around the location of actual characters on these different images. when there is a space, it actually learns as well to look at the left part of the image, even though saliency maps now is active. And yeah, the next letters. So I would say what is another exciting part from that model is that when we try to use it for business names, so predict, detect the Zelina Pneus text, so that's like the name of the business, Bridgestone and Firestone, that would be like the names of the tires that are available in this workshop. The model learned to like ignore digits, phone number, or ignore the logos, and just is able to read the business name without problems. That's another example of like reading the name. And what I like about this example is that usually what we see, at least with friends who were looking at this example, is that like most of the people would read Lambert's Tire Service. So that's like the our impression of the name of the business. But model prefers to read like maybe smaller font, but more standard, like without these waves and like looking up and down. So mostly focuses on that part of the image. So yeah, if you have problem around like summary or like what to take away, if you have problem that requires like reading the text and like making it in some form of like canonical, it's maybe a good idea to try this trick with some location cues inside your features. And this code is also available online in TensorFlow repo. So now I have like less than 10 minutes, so I will skip quickly through a few projects. Okay. So one of the works we are doing was trying to like do pixel-based instance segmentation, so doing like embedding of the pixels, and if embeddings are similar, we would treat them as the same instance of an object, which is very, I would say, different approach than standard way of doing object detection, and for every object, just detecting the mask. This is a nice idea. I don't think very reasonable, because our results were always worse than state of the art. So I don't think that's the like most successful part. I work also on Inception V3, which now is a quite old model. And maybe because Inception is like this architecture with like multiple different paths inside, to give like the main idea behind Inception, let me actually just show these two slides. So when we do a convolution, we take the tensor, we apply the kernel, and we get the output. So this is like example of the input and output. And this is exactly equivalent to doing this like in four different groups and just concatenating the output. So if we have like 128 channels, we can concatenate them and still get like 512 channels at the end. What Inception is about like saying, okay, based on this image, let's just group some channels together and just process these channels like independently from like other groups by having this 3x3 convolution on top of it, by just one by one convolution before that. And this simple trick actually gives like better results and is around like three times less like costful in terms of computation and parameters, and can also give like two times deeper network if we like put ReLUs in between. So that is like the main idea beyond Inception, one of the main ideas. So it's worth maybe to think about it. We were looking also at object detectors. So in 2016, we took part in the MS COCO detection challenge, and I would say the main outcome from this work is like standardizing the different models, looking at them from perspective of like single shot or like two-step detection, where we generate proposals and then we analyze with more computation like every of the, let's say, 300 proposals. And we generated this like very computational intensive plot that shows like the optimal line of choosing the detector for your computational budget. So depending on like how much time you can spend per image, you can try to find the best model that suits you. And if you want to control the speed of your models, there is actually very simple way to do this with just single parameter, like which is number of proposals. And that can give like already very good results with not so many proposals. Another project that I think is quite interesting that we did with friends from TensorFlight is looking at small objects. So we see that like ImageNet performance is extremely good and flattened. If it comes to object detector up to 2016, we've seen like a very steep progress. The same for 2017 and even this year. So this is still like problem that like actually advances a lot. And one of the main, I would say, challenges that we are facing today in object detector is about small objects. So if we look at the small object result versus large object results, there are at least 2 to 3 times lower for every model. So this is like example of state-of-the-art model from last year, MASCAR-CNN, and this is like, well, a lot of birds, and we just found 6 of them. Or here are very visible like cars, but because they are small, maybe slightly different perspective, and the model actually didn't find anyone beyond that one. So small object is definitely a challenge. And we have tried to tackle it by looking at the definition of small object, definition of like loss around it. I would say one of the reasons why we thought it's potentially like what could be potentially helpful is about like looking at anchors, which kind of tells you if like how object detector works is like for every part in the image you generate something what is called anchor, and in this canonical location you will find something like, for example, this red one or this red one. They're like equally distributed across the image. You would if you find something, you just classify this anchor as positive, as something is there, or negative if there is missing. And obviously, because they are equally distributed, for large anchors, there will be, and even if you move large anchor by a few pixels, it's still overlapping a lot. So you will have a lot of positive examples versus only few examples for like small images, for small objects, which this is a good example of such case. Like a lot of anchors are positive and only single for this animal probably. So so we try to kind of trick it by just copy pasting the small objects on the images. Very simple trick. What would do to anchors is something like that. If we would have like this kind of anchors, if we would copy paste, if we have large object, there would be like a lot of naturally occurring anchors. If we have small object, you just paste them a few times and there will be like more anchors during training. And surprise, surprise, it works better for small objects, but actually it works worse for large objects. And yeah, so that was not like super exciting result. Like we improved it for small ones, but like got the drawback in large ones. And I think, not our work, but I think some idea that really well tries to tackle it, and I think it's one step towards solving is called Snipe and Sniper, but I don't have time to mention it, but it's worth checking this out. And one of the last projects we did was actually also with Ken, who is here, is about like detection of cancer in mammograms. There were like 2 phases, so we were 9th and 2nd in the world, so that's pretty exciting. A lot of teams kind of competed in this challenge. And what is the data set? This is how it looks like. You get like a huge image, 4,000 by 4,000 pixels, and like less than 1 promille of that image will be pixels that have cancer. Even less. So there is only a few thousand of such images. Most of them, there is like few millions, but like negative ones, which means like only healthy. So it's much more difficult to train. Obviously, if you try to train classifier that starts from 4,000 by 4,000 and gives like single bit of information, if there is something on the image or not, it's very difficult. We try to tackle it with deformable convolutions and like our hand design Inception to be like smaller, that kind of lets fits you large image in your object detection model. So that is pretty interesting. We like cut part of the Inception, and in this way we could train like 2500 by 2500 pixel images, probably the biggest one I've ever seen in any work. So that's large, and yeah, that's most of the actually contribution here. There was like more competition phase, so we're like playing a lot with hyperparameters and just pushing the model for the time. And just to give you a quick catch up on what I'm doing, and if anyone is interested in like collaboration, research, or like business wise, we are building TensorFlight. I'm the founder. And in TensorFlight, we analyze, it's for insurance, we analyze like buildings in the physical world. So it's very interesting data set because it's a real one from satellite, aerial, airplanes, and street view. And we look at different perspectives of these images and try to understand buildings like height, number of floors, construction type, quality, etc., etc. And these features are actually influencing a lot the price on the policy when you try to insure the building. So it's very nice computer vision problem, very difficult actually, much more than we thought initially. And research-wise, we try to build models that are like merging these two different views, shots of the real world objects. That's it. So there is like, yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. So I think we have time for exactly one question. Anyone? Okay. So yeah, there was, I think, a lot to take in at this time of day. But thank you very much for this.
Thank you.
For both speakers and yes, our sponsors and everyone for coming. Thank you.